Sastra Preshu Apreshu Chambhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Tama Shokhe Bhagavati Rashiki. Reading from the Srimad Bhagavatam, 5th canto, what chapter is it? 19th chapter, 13th verse. 19th chapter, 13th verse. 19th chapter, 13th verse. Translations in the words of Christ of High Grace. Dami Yogeshwar Yoganai Punam.
Dami Yogeshwar Yoganai Punam.
Hiranyagarbho Bhagavan Jagariyat.
Hiranyagarbho Bhagavan Jagariyat.
Hiranyagarbho Bhagavan Jagariyat.
Hiranyagarbho Bhagavan Jagariyat.
Yadantakale Tvayi Nirgune Mano.
Yadantakale Tvayi Nirgune Mano.
Having given up
his identification
with the material body.
Translation by Srila Prabhupada. O my Lord, Master of all mystic yoga, this is the explanation of the yogic process spoken by Lord Brahma, Hiranyagarbha, who is self-realized. At the time of death, all yogis give up the material body with full detachment, simply by placing their minds at your lotus feet. This is the perfection of yoga. And responsibly, O my Lord, Master of all mystic yoga, this is the explanation of the yogic process spoken of by Lord Brahma, Hiranyagarbha, who is self-realized. At the time of death, all yogis give up the material body with full detachment. Simply by placing their minds, at your lotus feet. That is the perfection of yoga. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Sri Madhvacharya says, Yasya samyag bhagavati jnanam bhaktisthitai vacha ischintastasya omshasya sarvapapa krito pitu. For one who is very seriously practicing devotional service, during his lifetime, in order to understand the constitutional position of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, liberation from this material world is guaranteed, even if he has previously been addicted to sinful habits. This is also confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, Apichet Sudaracharo Bhajate Mamananyubhak Sadareva Samantabhya Samyak Vyavasito Isaha. Even if one commits the most abominable actions, if he is engaged in devotional service, he is to be considered saintly because he is properly situated. Bhagavad Gita 9.30. The only purpose of life is to be fully absorbed in thoughts of Krishna and his form, pastimes, activities, and qualities. If one is able to think of Krishna in this way 24 hours a day, he is already liberated. Svarupena yavastitihi. Whereas materialists are absorbed in material thoughts and activities, devotees, on the contrary, are always absorbed in thoughts of Krishna and Krishna's activities. Therefore, they are already on the platform of liberation. One has to think of Krishna with full absorption at the time of death. Then he will certainly return home, back to Godhead, without a doubt. Translation again by Srila Prabhupada. O my Lord, Master of all mystic yoga, this is the explanation of the yogic process spoken of by Lord Brahma, Hiranyagarbha, who is self-realized. At the time of death, all yogis give up their minds. The material body with full detachment, simply by placing their minds at the lotus feet. That is the perfection of yoga. There's another verse in the Bhagavad Gita. It's the end of chapter 6, I think it's verse number 47. It says, Yogi namapi sarve shamman kate antara manam shradhavyan bhajate yomam samayuktatamomata. And the purport is and the translation basically is that all yogis, the perfection of yoga is to think of Krishna at the time of death. In this purport, Prabhupada is emphasizing how important it is to remember Krishna at the time of death. It's also said in the Bhagavad Gita, Yam Yam Bhakti Smaram Bhavam, in the eighth chapter, that if one thinks of Krishna at the time of death, one's life is perfected. And there's another verse that's mentioned here in the purport, Abhichet Sudaracharo Bhajate Mamayan Ananyabha Sarariva Samantabhya Samyagyapa Satobhisa. That even if one is very sinful throughout life, if one is able to remember Krishna at the time of death, and if one is able to be engaged in devotional service, all of one's past sinful activities are eradicated. Sometimes we think of the Goswamis who are mentioned in other shastras as having identities in the spiritual sky and Krishna Loka. Having identities in Krishna Lila as being very saintly persons. Jiva Goswami was mentioned as being the greatest philosopher in the world when I was in London. I read this on the notice that was given by the School of Oriental and African Studies, part of London University. Jiva Goswami was described to study there, and he was described as being the greatest philosopher of the world, and he had translated some 400,000 Sanskrit verses, or he had written so many, composed that many Sanskrit verses. He was considered a great philosopher. But the point I'm making is that the disappearance days are in some sense more important than the appearance days. The Tirubhavas, which is Prabhupada's coming up on Sunday, the disappearance day of Prabhupada. Of course, Prabhupada's in a bit of a special category because his appearance day will always be very, very important and probably always celebrated very luxuriously. But in one sense, the disappearance days, like the Goswamis, are more important than the appearance days. We've heard that the Goswamis were in the service of the then ruling Mohammedan government of Bengal. So their earlier periods of life are not necessarily considered so important. Also, in the sixth canto, it's talked about, we're going to be reading this a little bit later, about Ajamil and how he had a very sinful past, but at the time of death, because he was chanting the name of Krishna Narayan, who was the name of his son, even so, he was approached by the Vishnu Buddhas who argued with the Yamadutas and caused him to go away, even though he lived a very sinful life. He's a very special person, Ajamil. Even though he was very sinful, he was a very unusual person. It's described, I think, in the sixth canto that he was 88 years old when he passed away, and he was still having children when he was 85 years old. So that's a pretty unusual thing. But he was at least an older. He was considered old, and in the age of Kali, since the lifespan is only 100 years maximum, he was probably talked about in another age of Kali. It's described as the incident of Ajamil took place in a remote period in history. So it's kind of a relief after reading the last chapter in the fifth canto about all the different kinds of hellish punishments that one has to undergo. I mean, you know, really awful punishments, worse than burning. I mean, torturous. And it's a great relief to read the sixth canto, at least it was for me, to realize that if somehow or other one is able to hear about Krishna or to chant Krishna's name at the time of death, then one can be relieved from all sinful activity. There's another verse, I think it's in the 10th canto, maybe? If someone can bring that. I think it's the 14th chapter. Yeah, 8th verse. I think it's the 10th canto is in there. I think it's in the third part of the 10th canto. It's 14th verse. De tuna kam pamu samikshamano. Basically, the translation is that if one is able to tolerate the different difficulties that come about, the types of punishments that come about in this body, in this age of Kali, one can and earnestly wait for Krishna's mercy, even though suffering. Sometimes suffering or a curse is considered a blessing. Yeah. Is it there? Part 3, I think. Or maybe it's a, I don't know. 10th canto, chapter 14, I think it is. Part 3. That's the Sanskrit. It's the 14th chapter.
What's the start of the Sanskrit?
Te-tu. Oh, here it is. Thank you. This is the one. Te-tu nukam pam sisamikshamano bunja eva kritam vipakam. Vidvagvakubir vidadam namaste jivete yo mukti pade sadayava. I'm just going to read the translations and purports. My dear Lord, one who earnestly waits for you to bestow your causeless mercy upon him, all the while patiently suffering the reactions of his past misdeeds, and offering you respectful obeisances with his heart, words, and body, is surely eligible for liberation, for it has become his rightful claim. Purport reads, Sridhar Swami explains in his commentary that just as legitimate sons have to be able to remain alive to gain an inheritance from their father, one who simply remains alive in Krishna consciousness, following the regulated principles of Bhakti Yoga, automatically becomes eligible to receive the mercy of the personality of Godhead. In other words, he will be promoted to the kingdom of God. The word Susamikshamana indicates that a devotee earnestly awaits the mercy of the Supreme Lord, even while suffering the painful effects of previous sinful activities. Lord Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita that a devotee who fully surrenders unto him is no longer liable to suffer the reactions of his previous karma. However, because in his mind a devotee removes the last vestiges of the enjoying spirit by giving his devotee punishments, that may sometimes resemble sinful activities. The purpose of the entire creation of God is to rectify the living entity's tendency to enjoy without the Lord, and therefore the particular punishment given for sinful activity is specifically designed to curtail the mentality that produced the activity. Although a devotee has surrendered to the Lord's devotional service, until he is completely perfect in Krishna consciousness, he may maintain a slight inclination to enjoy the false happiness of this world. The Lord, therefore, creates a particular situation to eradicate this remaining enjoying spirit. This unhappiness, suffered by a sincere devotee, is not technically a karmic reaction. It is rather the Lord's special mercy for inducing his devotee to completely let go of the material world and return home back to Godhead. A sincere devotee earnestly desires to go back to the Lord's abode. Therefore, he willingly accepts the Lord's merciful punishment and continues offering respects and obeisances to the Lord with his heart, words, and body. Such a bona fide servant of the Lord, considering all hardship a small price to pay for gaining the personal association of the Lord, certainly becomes a legitimate son of God, as indicated here by the words Dayat Bhak. Just as one cannot approach the sun without becoming fire, one cannot approach the supreme pure, Lord Krishna, without understanding a rigid purificatory process, which may appear like suffering, but which is in fact a curative treatment administered by the personal hand of the Lord. So sometimes it's been said that suffering is a form of purification, so that's what it really means. And it was Queen Kunti that praised in the 8th chapter of the first canto that may these calamities continuously come upon us. She was talking about the fact that the Pandavas were tempted to be killed. They were tempted to be poisoned. They were given a poisonous cake. They were tempted to be burned in a house made of lacquer, of shellac, and so on. And she says that what looked like curses were actually blessings in the form of disguise. And she prayed that these kinds of things would happen again and again because she could always remember the Lord's lotus feet. So any comments or anything you want to say, I guess?
How easy is it to live a Krishna kind of faith? I mean, is it a very rare thing, or?
Is it a very great thing?
How easy is it to live a Krishna kind of faith? Is it a very rare thing?
From what I understand, it's a very rare thing to think of Krishna at the time of death, because one thinks at the time of death what one is most attached to. And like Ajamil, he was very attached to his three-year-old son, Narayan. So he was chanting his name because he was very... But because it was the name of Krishna, it was recognized by Krishna. And one of the acharyas says that he actually chanted it in Bhakti because he felt very helpless. He had tears in his eyes when he saw the Yamadutas. So some people have even opined that when he chanted the name of Narayana, it awakened his original Krishna consciousness, because he was actually born in a very aristocratic, rabbinical family. But in any case, the idea is somehow or other, the term somehow or other is used, I think, by Prabhupada, one should chant Krishna's name at the time of leaving the body. There's also a Bengali proverb, and it's also mentioned in different shastras that that one's consciousness is tested at the time of death. Antasmanane, at the time of death, one should remember Krishna. Other comments? Yes. Well, there's two different, the question was, what's the difference between the enjoying spirit and happiness? Actually, there's two kinds of happiness. One is the material happiness, it's enjoyment of the material world. In the spirit of enjoyment, one can enjoy nature, one can enjoy music, one can enjoy the opposite sex, one can enjoy intoxication, one can enjoy many things in different modes, but they're still material. Whereas love of Krishna is considered to be pure and perfect, that kind of happiness is ultimate happiness. And the other kind of happiness, material happiness, tends it must end with the material body, no matter how much we enjoy it. We may enjoy nature and think that nature is going to exist even after we die, but when we die, we can't think of beautiful nature, therefore it comes to an end. So material things, material enjoyment is impure, it has a beginning and end, and it's a mixture of the modes of nature, it's a mixture of goodness, passion, and ignorance. Usually one is predominant, but material enjoyment, or the spirit of enjoyment, is like that. I was walking in Potomac with a friend of mine from Russia, and he said that all these people seem to be smiling, they're in a spirit of enjoyment. But that spirit of enjoyment would go away when they return to their homes, or when they return to their television, or whatever, when they have to die. But the enjoyment of enjoying with Krishna is real happiness, because it doesn't end. It doesn't end with the body, even though we have to die. We have to be relieved of these material bodies. The real happiness is to engage in love of Krishna, because that is pure, and that continues even after the body. It disappears.
So, also you're saying how Kunti was praying for calamities, and she obviously had Krishna consciousness, and therefore she had happiness, but she was feeling stressed. So, to me, happiness means that you feel happy, not that you feel distressed. But in saying that to gain Krishna consciousness means that happy.
Well, sometimes then she was asking a little about how Kunti wanted to experience misery and would thereby be remembering Krishna, even though it would be unhappy. Is that correct?
Oh, yeah. It seems that
the
happiness is actually distress.
So she was praying for distress rather than happiness. And so it so happens that most people remember Krishna when they're in distress. Or there's four types of people who come to Krishna consciousness, and it's been said that most people come to Krishna consciousness because they're at the end of their rope, so to speak. They're suffering. They're unhappy. People tend to remember Krishna, but there's some solace in remembering Krishna even when one is unhappy, because we realize that this isn't the be all and end all of existence. That we have to leave the body, we have to die at some point. We have to give up material enjoyment. So even though it's a form of suffering, sometimes we have to suffer, but we're aware that Krishna is never unhappy. Krishna never has a bad day, and we never have a bad day when we're in Krishna consciousness. So whether we're suffering in the material world or enjoying in the material world, it's all temporary. But real happiness is to enjoy with Krishna. And so even at the time of death, or when one is suffering or experiencing a near-death experience or something like that, in a very unhappy way, there's a kind of happiness that occurs, because that's the spiritual purity. And even when one is suffering materially, when one remembers Krishna, one is actually very happy. So there's a combination of happiness and distress happening at the same time in those kinds of situations. Yes?
Is it easier to be Krishna consciously happy when you're materially happy?
Well, it's Srila Vishwanath Chakrabarti Thakur writes that if you're material happy and materially happy and Krishna consciousness happy, that's a very elevated stage. But most people are Krishna conscious happy when they're materially suffering. That's why most of us come to Krishna consciousness, because we realize that there's no permanent enjoyment. And in fact, I think it was Sanatana Goswami, who was a very materially well off and materially enjoying. He was a prime minister of the Mohammedan government, and he was very highly respected and adulated by all of his contemporaries. And when he approached Lord Chaitanya, he said, people call me a sadhu. I don't know the exact translation, but that's a famous shloka in the Chaitanya Chaitanya, the Prabhupada quotes. People call me a sadhu, he says, but what kind of a sadhu am I? Who am I? That was Kayani. That was the thing he asked of Lord Chaitanya. Who actually, I don't know who I am. People exalt me and they think I'm very learned. They call me a sadhu, but I don't know who I am. So what kind of a sadhu am I? So even though he was materially very, you know, enjoying, there was something that was incomplete. So in a sense that he was actually suffering because he didn't know who he was, even though he appeared to be materially enjoying life. So it's a very unusual person who can enjoy material life and be very Krishna conscious at the same time. It's a very unusual thing. Usually one has to have a feeling of incompletion or suffering to take to Krishna consciousness. Does that make any sense?
Just one quick question, please, Raj. You quoted the comment, which I think all the devotees know of, if one commits engaging in abominable activities, he's considered saintly, he's rightly situated in devotional service. Mm. I was most abominable when I came to Krishna consciousness a fair while ago, but I use that as an excuse to continue my abominable actions, specifically intoxication. Now, would that be a fairly rare thing that people may misinterpret that and say, well, okay, looks as though I might be able to get around this one? Pertaining to continuing the abominable actions on the basis of I'm engaged in devotional service.
Well, that's a pretty big stretch to continue abominable activities on the strength of saying that suffering is the way to attain Krishna consciousness. Because Krishna consciousness has a behavioral aspect. When one goes deep into Krishna consciousness, one has to give up certain things, including intoxication. So suffering, you know, we may be suffering or feeling incomplete or somehow or other, and that brings us to Krishna consciousness. But once we become Krishna consciousness, we vow to give up certain things, to live a certain a purer lifestyle. So Krishna consciousness is a kind of purification of our consciousness. Yeah. And without realizing that, it has to be a purificatory process. It's not fully Krishna conscious. Because it's actually a way of purifying our consciousness. And to think that all material things are actually abominable, and not only abominable, but have to be abandoned for one to be fully Krishna conscious.
Thank you.
So I think we're going to chant down the rest of the prayers now. Okay.
Would you like to chant
for me? Hare Krishna. I'll chant Hare Krishna, but you can chant the other prayers, or somebody else can.
Alright.
Some people think the month of that extra, what's that extra month called?
Purushottam.
Yeah, Purushottam month is more sacred than Kartika month.
Thank you.
Хорошо, вот это как это проходит.